I'm Ben Powell. I'm the director of the Free Market Institute here at Texas Tech University. I'm pleased to have you all here for our event today. One of the things among many that the Institute does is sponsor the public lecture series on campus for about three times a semester. We have leading academics and public intellectuals come through to give lectures to undergraduate students, faculty, staff, general public here. And this is part of that. This is actually kind of a special one because this is also done in conjunction with a conference that we're hosting starting tonight for PhD students and faculty here and actually from around the country and in some cases from other countries. Like we've got a contingent from Guatemala here today. Finishing off a three-year research grant that we had from the generosity of the John Templeton Foundation on the origins of economic freedom and prosperity. And Amy Prue here is from the Templeton Foundation tonight to be here for our conference as well. And the theme of this research grant was to study the origins of freedom and prosperity. So the idea was we have a lot of scholarship about the benefits and for that matter the costs of free markets and what they provide in terms of prosperity, but a whole lot less knowledge about the social change dynamics and processes that go into making a place become more or less free. And that's what the three-year research grant has been studying, and the conference kicking off tonight and running through the day tomorrow has a whole bunch of new research papers that explore that. And while organizing it, I thought it would be great to have one of our public events feature some of the prominent speakers who would be keynoting the conference that we're having. And I'm very pleased to have one of those three with us tonight. Unfortunately, if you got the announcement that came out, two of them, one has pneumonia and one had an emergency procedure at a hospital this week. One will be Skyping in for the conference but couldn't join us for the panel tonight. However, a nice thing about doing this in conjunction with the conference is the talent runs deep. We have academics from around the country here who are here to present research for it. And two of them, Peter Boettke and Alex Nowrasteh, I'm very grateful for them filling in to participate in this panel discussion on it tonight. So what I'll do for this event is I'll introduce all three speakers, ask you to come up and join the table, and then each one of them will have about 15 minutes to give their thoughts about prospects for freedom and prosperity here in the United States, or for that matter, around the globe. And then we'll open it up for questions from the audience for all three of them at that point. So our first speaker is Professor Douglas Irwin. He's the John Sloan Dickey, third century professor in social sciences at the Department of Economics at Dartmouth College. He's the author of Free Trade Under Fire with Princeton University Press, Against the Tide, an Intellectual History of Free Trade, also with Princeton, and three other books, as well as scores of articles published in professional journals on topics related to international trade and other issues. He's a frequent commentator on op-ed pages, in particular the Wall Street Journal. You've seen it sitting up there here in the business school and picked it up day after day. If you've been doing that for a year, you've probably seen a few of his columns there. He's also a research associate with the National Bureau of Economic Research and has served on the staff of the President's Council of Economic Advisors and the Federal Reserve's Board of Governors. Alex Nowrasteh, who will be speaking second, is an immigration policy analyst at the Cato Institute's Center for Global Liberty and Prosperity. His popular publications have also appeared in the Wall Street Journal, USA Today, Boston Globe, LA Times, and scores of other papers. He has also appeared on Fox News, Bloomberg, plenty of other TV shows. In fact, if you've tuned in recently, one of my favorite pastimes has been seeing him spar with Tucker Carlson, arguing on Fox News lately. Those have been quite entertaining. He has also published in numerous scholarly journals and has a CV on scholarly grounds that merit tenure at other universities, including here at Texas Tech. Peter Boettke is our third speaker. He's a university professor of economics and philosophy at George Mason University, where he's also the BB&T professor for the study of capitalism and the director of the FA Hayek program in advanced study in philosophy, politics, and economics at the Mercatus Center at George Mason. He's the author of more than 100 articles and 10 books, including Living Economics, Yesterday, Today, and Tomorrow. He's currently the president of both the Montpelier Society and the Southern Economic Association. Please join me in welcoming all three speakers. The three of you come on up.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here. I guess if the theme is free markets and how we can ensure continued economic prosperity into the 21st century, well, my area of expertise is international trade. I would think that it was very difficult to maintain a market-based economy without having largely free international trade. And here, at least looking at the United States, I think we see a huge disconnect, between the American public and the new administration. So if you look at public opinion polls, such as those put out by Pew Research, about two-thirds of Americans think that foreign trade is an opportunity for the United States. An opportunity for economic betterment, an opportunity for economic growth, and continued economic expansion. About one-third think it's a threat, that foreign trade represents a threat to U.S. economy and U.S. prosperity. And actually, those numbers are pretty wide in favor of viewing international trade as an opportunity rather than a threat. It bounces around in the past. But that's actually a pretty wide margin that Americans are optimistic about foreign trade. But when you turn to the current administration, they tend to have a very different view. So if you look at President Trump's campaign rhetoric during the campaign, obviously, and also his inaugural address and some of the comments he's made since then, it's very much based on economic nationalism, very much based on an America first trade policy. Foreign trade is not just a threat. We've reached disastrous trade agreements. Imports are killing us. And that he said, as his inaugural address, that he wants protection as something to strengthen the U.S. economy. So now the president hasn't actually defined what his trade policy will be, and there's a lot of contradictions. I think former Vice President Joe Biden put it best when he said Trump is a Rubik's Cube. We just don't know what's going to happen, and we haven't seen anything happen quite yet in terms of trade policy. But he, one of the first actions he did is withdraw the United States from the Trans-Pacific Partnership, the TPP, which is a major trade agreement among about 12 Pacific Rim countries, and the U.S. Was a leader in negotiating that. Now, he's pulled us out of that. That just means sort of the status quo holds. We're not going to be opening up the Japanese market for American beef coming from Texas. I'm not sure Texas ranchers would be very much, are delighted with the prospect that there's going to be no TPP, since they're competing with Australian beef in the Japanese market and a lot of other markets. But the president has also said he wants to reach bilateral agreements with all the TPP partners. Well, then the question is, I can understand why you not like TPP and want to raise barriers against Asian countries, but why would you not want TPP, but then reach bilateral trade agreements with those same exact 12 partners? There's been no identification about what you get with a bilateral agreement, how you get a better deal, whatever that constitutes, bilaterally as opposed to regionally. And in fact, in attacking NAFTA and attacking TPP, the president's never really identified, well, what is it that about those agreements that he doesn't like? He doesn't sort of like the outcomes, to some extent, in terms of imports coming in, and he talks about job dislocation, but he's never really said what he would do differently. What constitutes a better agreement? And in fact, here's where there's a big mismatch between what these trade agreements actually do and the economic outcomes that he has a lot of complaint about. So I'll sort of wrap up by talking about four or five misconceptions. Another contradiction is that he just the other day praised Andrew Jackson, said I'm sort of a Jacksonian. Well, Jackson wanted lower tariffs, not higher tariffs. And a couple days later, he went to Kentucky and praised Henry Clay. Well, Henry Clay hated Andrew Jackson. Clay wanted much higher tariffs. So once again, that's sort of this contradiction. You know, which historical figure is he going to embrace in terms of charting his future economic policy? So let me just talk about some of the misunderstandings that are common in the public and certainly, I think, within the administration about some of these trade agreements and things of that sort. So what is the trade deficit is a bad thing, and as an indicator of that these trade agreements have been misfired by the U.S. Well, first of all, what these trade agreements do is establish the rules of the road. So NAFTA, as you may know, Texas has been a major beneficiary of NAFTA, and it has played a major role. What NAFTA does is essentially take relatively low U.S. tariffs and drop them to zero, and take relatively high Mexican tariffs and drop them to zero. So that's sort of a level playing field. Now, it is true that we have a trade deficit with Mexico, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. It's certainly not an indicator of the gains from trade. It's certainly not an indicator of what trade agreements do. Trade agreements don't guarantee a certain outcome. Trade agreements establish the rules by which trade will take place. When we have a trade surplus with Mexico, now we have a trade deficit. Partly that's because 40% of the value of U.S. imports from Mexico are U.S. components. So there's a lot of components that are going back and forth in terms of production sharing between the two. And that means the trade deficit is, to some extent, misleading. When a car comes in from Mexico, it's not really a Mexican-made car, so a lot of U.S. parts have gone into that. And do we want to deduct those parts in terms of attributing them to Mexico, or do we not? So the numbers here matter quite a bit. Another misconception is jobs. We've lost a lot of manufacturing jobs, supposedly because of these trade agreements. Well, if you look at the share of U.S. employment in manufacturing, it's undergone a secular decline since the 1950s. And that's because we've moved towards a service-based economy. It hasn't stopped us from becoming a richer economy, moving towards services. And what's happened in manufacturing is not so much that it's been undermined by foreign competition, decimated by imports, but that what's happened in manufacturing is what's happened in agriculture over the past two centuries as well. That is, we can get more and more agricultural output with fewer and fewer workers because we become more productive. That's exactly what's been going on in manufacturing. We're still more manufacturing more than we ever have in past history, but we have many fewer workers in manufacturing because we move towards technologically advanced capital-intensive production methods. So a good example would be the steel industry, which the Trump administration seems to want to embrace. It's a great idea, perhaps, to increase steel output, but we're not going to create a lot of steel jobs. In the 1980s, it took 10 worker hours to produce a ton of steel. Now it takes 2 worker hours to produce a ton of steel. So even if we're to sort of miraculously increase our output of steel, it's still not going to be a lot of jobs behind them because we can create more output with fewer workers. Usually economists think that's a good thing. We want more output with fewer less labor, and that frees us up to do other things. Somehow we've got this view that we want more Americans on the assembly lines rather than doing other activities. Another misconception would be the WTO and U.S. sovereignty. The World Trade Organization somehow compromises U.S. sovereignty. And once again, it's never quite identified how that happens because the text of the WTO agreements were largely written and proposed by the United States. When we go into these negotiating situations, the U.S. basically has a template of what we'd like to see. Other countries basically have to buy onto that or not. So if we're complaining about the WTO, we're sort of complaining about where we ourselves wrote. Now, the complaint is always that, well, what other countries can bring us a case against us to the WTO, and we lose those cases. Well, what is often overlooked is the fact that almost every single case the U.S. brings against other countries, we win. And that's just sort of the nature of the beast. You only bring strong cases. So when we violate the agreement, we should be held accountable for that. But when other countries violate the agreement, too, remember, this covers over 150 other countries, holding them to very high standards in terms of how they can treat our goods and our exports and their job behind those exports. We can hold them into account as well. And then the last misconception is that somehow if we move towards protecting higher tariffs, limits on imports, that this will strengthen the U.S. economy. In fact, I think it will achieve almost none of the purported objectives that a lot of proponents will simply say. It's not going to reduce the trade deficit, because the trade deficit is dictated by capital flows into the United States rather than trade policy per se. So why do we have the trade deficit? Basically, when we turn over $1 to China or some other country, if they return that dollar to us and buying us goods, we'd have balanced trade. Now, about 75 cents of that dollar does come back and buy U.S. goods, but about 25 cents, or now down to about 20 cents, buys a U.S. asset. That is, they're investing in the United States, either in terms of direct investments making products here, or in terms of buying our treasury bills. Now, if we didn't have such a big fiscal budget deficit, we wouldn't have to issue so many treasury bills that other countries might want to buy. But there's no problem, I think, in BMW saying we'd like to build a plant in South Carolina. But that means we're going to have a trade deficit because that means a capital inflow from the United States. Germany runs a fiscal surplus. They also run a trade surplus. Maybe if we want to run a trade surplus, I'm not saying that's a good objective in and of itself, but if we as a country want to run a trade surplus, maybe we should balance our books at the federal government level because that will help rectify that situation. In addition, protectionism is not going to bring back many manufacturing jobs, if any at all. And that's because, first of all, there are a lot of manufacturing jobs that are based on our U.S. export base. And we know that as soon as the U.S. starts raising trade barriers, other countries are going to respond by raising trade barriers against us. If we start hitting China too hard, or Mexico, or some of our European allies, very quickly, those other countries can start buying Australian wheat instead of American wheat, Argentine soybeans instead of American soybeans, Airbus aircraft instead of Boeing aircraft. Doesn't take even protectionism on the other parts. They can start shifting their purchases away from the United States, and that would be to the detriment of the United States. And so when you look at the fact that protectionism will not reduce the trade deficit, will not create a lot of manufacturing jobs, in fact, will harm a lot of those jobs that are dependent on exports, and also will result in retaliation or further restrict trade, that's something, a road I don't think we want to go down. So I think one lesson the Trump administration might teach us if they start going down this road is that you never really miss something until you don't have it anymore. Maybe we don't like the world with NAFTA, but take away NAFTA and see if that brings about a better world. I sincerely doubt it, because I think the worst case scenario would be is that our trade policies, by offending Mexico, lead to the election of an anti-American populist leader, nationalist leader in Mexico that wants to realign the country away from the United States towards, say, Chavez in Venezuela, or Castro's in Cuba, or whoever takes over after them. In other words, there are foreign policy consequences to alienating your trading partners. That's one of the great unfortunate lessons of the 1930s with the Sloan tariff. Not only was it economically damaging, but more importantly, I think, was it was politically damaging. So it's not a coincidence that shortly after the U.S. passed that high tariff in the 1930s, that played some role in the Great Depression, that Canada went from a pro-American open trade policy to an anti-American pro-British restrictive trade policy that favored Britain instead of us, and those consequences we had to live with for some time. So Richard Cooper, a famous Harvard economist, always said that trade policy is foreign policy. It's not just a matter of economics, but there are important political and foreign policy and national security consequences as well. And I think that the U.S. retreat from the world towards economic nationalism and protectionism would be a step very much in the wrong direction. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Ben. It's quite a pleasure to be here today, and thank you to Texas Tech and all of you for being here. When I was in grad school, I had to read a lot of Professor Irwin's papers, and they were actually a pleasure. And so it's really an honor to be here on this panel, and I have a dog-eared copy of one of Boettke's books, Living Economics, on my shelf. So I can say this is probably one of the most prestigious panels I've ever been on. So it's quite an honor to be here today. Talking about immigration in the United States is always an interesting topic. I think the U.S. history with immigration is one of the most interesting in the entire world. Have you ever heard this phrase, nation state, before? Everyone's heard this phrase, nation state. Well, in American context, it sounds redundant. Why nation state? Sort of like saying country state or something like that. Why do we say nation state? That's because most countries in the world have a conception of being a member of that country that's tied up in ethnicity or race. That's the Latin root of the word nation. Natio means birth or origin, and it's mostly used to define ethnicity or tribe. Now, in the United States, that doesn't make any sense. The largest ethnic group in the United States by self-identification is German. That's 17%. Every other group is smaller than that by self-identification, by ancestry. Talk about yourself being a blood American is a pretty ludicrous notion. You just need to take a look at the last names of the people on this panel or in this room who are all Americans, I think, to realize that the backgrounds and continents where they come from. And that's the result of having a country that from 1790 to 1875 had total open borders. You could land anywhere and come in. There were no federal laws restricting that. There were no prohibitions. There were some state laws, but nothing like that. And gradually from 1875 to 1924, the border was closed and remained closed from 1924 until about 1965 when it was gradually opened. And this is the situation we're in today. We have a foreign-born population of about 14% in the U.S. That includes legal and illegal immigrants here currently. That is about close to the maximum percentage that we had in the past between about 1850 and 1920. The rates of assimilation today are at par with what we've seen in the past in terms of picking up language, in terms of assimilating, in terms of the family size, in terms of economics, in terms of education, in terms of people saying that the U.S. is the best country in the world, in terms of their identification and patriotism and all these things that we can measure. The rate of assimilation of immigrants to descendants today is the same as it was in the heyday of American immigration in the late 19th and early 20th century. But the pessimism today is also, unfortunately, not that different. There is a famous book written in 1926 called The Melting Pot Mistake by a famous Yale sociologist called Henry Pratt Fairchild. And he argued that all the Italians, Jews, Russians, Poles, Eastern and Southern Europeans that had come in from about 1890, 1924 would never assimilate. Their kids would never assimilate, their grandkids would never assimilate because their characteristics, whether they're ethnic, racial, religious, cultural characteristics, would make it impossible for them to become American. That was obviously untrue. I think the benefit of history has shown that to be false. But we hear the same arguments today about immigrants and their descendants, mainly about their cultures, and it's turning out to be false as well. Now the benefits, and this is too bad, that we have so much pessimism over something that has turned out so well over so much of American history. The benefits of immigration are tremendous economically. Economists have this measurement called a place premium. It is the wage gains that an identical worker can make moving from their home country to the United States. And economics is the main reason why people move. It's the reason why most of our ancestors moved. It's the reason why most people move today. The median wage benefit for a worker with a high school degree and 9 years of education moving from their home country, poor, undeveloped country to the United States is a four-fold increase in wages. fourfold increase in wages. For Mexican, with that same type of education, it's about a threefold increase. For somebody from Haiti, it's a tenfold increase. For somebody from Yemen, it's a 15-fold increase coming to the United States. And the reason why wages increase so much for these workers is that they're much more productive when they get to this country. Due to free markets in the United States, contract rights, peace, accumulated capital, and all the other good things that come from free markets, these workers are tremendously more productive here, and that's why they make more money in the United States. Economist Michael Clemens wrote a paper called $1 trillion Bills on the Sidewalk, where he did some very simple estimations and basically wrote a lit survey and estimated, using some general equilibrium models, that global open borders, if any worker could move from any country in the world to any other country and make more money there, would increase global GDP by 50 to 150% per year, which is an additional $35 to $105 trillion of additional annual output. Now, I live and work in DC, and even in DC, that's a lot of money. The funny thing is, the present value of that is about $250 billion. And quadrillion is a real number, by the way. I had to look that up as well to find out how many zeros did when I did the present value. But let's say it's off by an order of magnitude and it's 90% smaller than that. That's still, we're talking about real numbers and real gains. Now, most people don't care about these numbers because most of the gains from immigration go to the immigrants themselves. About 98% of that benefit goes to the immigrants themselves. Now, George Borjas of Harvard University has done a lot of work on this, and what he has found is that immigrants to the United States, they get about 98% of the benefits of coming here, but native-born Americans get about 2% of those benefits in terms of higher wage, such that the wage benefits for Americans on average is positive. It's not huge, but it is positive. Now, there are concentrated costs, likely. Americans with less than a high school degree who are the ones most likely to compete with immigrants probably face some wage competition. And that is probably an explanation, partial explanation at least, for why wages have not grown very much for Americans with less than a high school degree or have actually gone down. But what is interesting is Americans with only a high school degree or every other level of education, part of the reason why their wages have gone up is due to immigration. So Borjas' most famous recent paper on the Mariel Bolliff found, and if we recall the Mariel Bolliff 1980, Miami's population increased by 7% over the course of 6 months due to 125,000 Cubans who were forced out of Cuba in the course of that, of just a six-month period. He found that the wages in Miami did fall for Americans with less than a high school degree, but he also found, he didn't report this in his peer-reviewed paper, so I had to recreate his entire paper from scratch and find this, so it took quite a while, so I'm a little bitter about that. But one of the things he didn't report is that wages for Americans with a high school degree using all of the same methods increased substantially at the same exact time that this huge immigration occurred. Such that Americans, if you take a look at those with just high school degree and below, actually saw a net wage increase at the same time that the Mariel Bolliff occurred. The peer-reviewed academic literature is pretty uniform on this. The economic benefits for Americans outweigh the costs of immigration, just if you count the benefits and costs to Americans. If you exclude entirely the immigrants themselves, assume that what they gain is worth zero, and we don't want to count them at all, the benefits are still positive for the United States. That leads us, of course, to the fiscal impact, the impact on taxpayers. How does immigration affect the net tax burden in the United States? We do have a large welfare state today, something very different from the past. How does this affect it? I wrote a very long, somewhat dry peer-reviewed piece for a book that Professor Powell put together, a literature survey of all the academic research I could find in this topic, and the uninteresting but kind of hopeful answer is that it doesn't really affect it one way or the other. So immigrants basically pay for their own way in terms of fiscal costs and benefits in the United States. So they don't really increase budget deficits, and they don't really cause surpluses. Now, talking about the current political situation, what's interesting is, similar to trade, support for increasing immigration in American polls is at historic highs. It's about 25%. To give you a perspective, about 20 years ago, it was about 7%. Compared to 20 years ago, 66% of Americans in Gallup polls wanted to cut legal immigration, 66%. Now that number is down to 38%. But what's surprising is that the President Donald Trump, I mean, the signature issue of his campaign, a top issue, I would argue, was the issue of immigration. Was the immigration issue of both trying to secure the border as well as restricting legal immigration. His position paper that he put out and the policies that he proposed and the positions adopted by the Republican Party in this election posed cutting legal immigration by 63%. I'm going to say that again because people usually forget this. He wanted during the election to cut legal immigration by 63%. And apparently, this being a signature issue, that was enough to put him over the top. Now, these types of elections are occurring in Europe as well. A lot of populist candidates are coming up very shortly. The Brexit decision was the decision of the EU to leave the European Union, which could be good or bad. We don't really know yet. But it was in large part due to fear over immigration and the free movement zone of the EU. There were recent elections in the Netherlands, where Geert Wilders, who is a populist anti-immigrant candidate in the Netherlands, was projected to do very well. He did not. Marine Le Pen, who is a, a nationalist candidate in France, is running on an anti-immigrant platform, amongst other things like anti-trade. Sort of a nationalist French platform, is projected to do very well in the upcoming French elections. So this is not just an American phenomenon. This is coming in other places around the world. And in terms of what we can expect from policy going forward in the United States, we've already seen, I think, some taste of it. We've seen an increase in immigration enforcement in the United States. Donald Trump did sign an executive order to do that. So he's going back basically to the Obama-era enforcement between the ages of 2009-2012, where President Obama massively increased immigration enforcement in the United States. So Donald Trump is basically going back to that category or level of enforcement. In terms of an amnesty or any kind of legalization for illegal immigrants, I think that we can safely say that's off the table, except for maybe people who are brought here as very young children. There might be some movement for that coming forward in the near future. In terms of enforcement, the president wants to increase the number of Border Patrol agents by over 5,000. There are currently 20,000 or so Border Patrol agents. It's just about at its historic highs. There have never been more Border Patrol agents on the southwest border. There's never been more strict enforcement in the southwest border, but apparently that's not enough. He also wants to ramp up interior enforcement by hiring 10,000 additional ICE agents. He wants to mandate a program called E-Verify, which means that every time you get a job, the government, your employer has to run your name through a government database, and that database says whether you're approved to work or not. You can understand all the other problems that come with that, such as inaccuracies. The inaccuracies, of course, are due to certain loopholes in the system, loopholes that have been proposed to be closed by creating a national biometric identity card that would supposedly prove that, close those loopholes, all for the purposes of immigration enforcement. Of course, any national biometric identity card will be used for everything else, like buying guns or renting apartments and opening bank accounts or anything else. So we can have to take that as a cost of immigration enforcement. In terms of cutting back in the legal system, the president has cut the refugee program by over 50% since getting into office. He is pursuing additional regulations and guest worker visa programs and temporary migration systems. He has not endorsed a bill to cut green cards yet, but Senator Cotton, a Republican from Arkansas, and Senator Perdue, a Republican from Georgia, have introduced a bill that would cut the number of green cards by over 50% in the United States annually, based very much on Trump rhetoric, based on what he said during the campaign trail. That bill is probably dead on arrival, but this is the first major bill introduced, at least in my time, to reduce the number of green cards. So things are not going in a very good direction politically on this. One of the only things I will say that's good to wrap up about this is that the president's executive actions, especially his bumbling release of his executive actions that restricted the refugee program and put a temporary ban on migrants and green card holders from seven majority Muslim countries, the first rollout of that executive order was so full of legal errors and so successfully challenged in the courts that he basically rescinded it and had to issue a new one. It caused huge delays, lawsuits, over 400,000 people with visas were affected. by that rollout. And it was so uncommon and poorly done that he rescinded an initiative, a new one, that dealt with a lot of the legal issues. So the notion that he can do whatever he wants in terms of immigration is coming up against reality in the courts. The public perception, I think, has changed from him being a tough enforcer just in the last couple months to him sort of being a little incompetent. And I think that vision of incompetence, should it continue, will be one of the best ways for to make sure that he does not enforce or put in place an immigration policy that restricts legal immigration to the United States. So that's the political case right now, the political situation. And with that, I will pass it over to B.
Okay. Texas Tech, and I also want to sort of point something out publicly to people here. I have a good opportunity to travel quite a bit around the world and visit a lot of research centers and graduate education programs. And in my opinion, Texas Tech has done one of the most amazing jobs, one of the most intellectually exciting places actually in the world in graduate education and research. And I think Ben has just been phenomenal in that position. So thank you for inviting me and also for this amazing program that you're building. Mark Twain, sort of the great economist, he had a great phrase. He said, the only thing worse than a young pessimist is an old optimist. So I'm weird because I'm an old optimist, but I was also a young optimist. And part of the reason why I'm optimistic is because of the power of economics once it's unleashed. The greatest resource is the human imagination. You unleash the human imagination by giving people freedom, and you'll be able to overcome a lot of ridiculous policies. Adam Smith actually had this as part of his idea. Two ideas he had. One is a lot of ruin in a nation. And the second one was that the power of individuals to overcome what he called and in 100 impertinent obstructions of human folly is just unbounded. Question that you have to ask to Adam Smith if he was here was, what about a million obstructions? You know, at some point, you know, is there a tipping point? And so I am optimistic, but pessimistically optimistic about the future. And so let me lay out what I think are the challenges that we face in our economy, and what I think are the fortunes of economic liberalism as a consequence of these. So I'll start with the first one, which is the fiscal gap. It should be no surprise to any of you that our national debt is nearing $20 trillion. But that's kind of an optimistic number. If you actually look at the intergenerational accounting, and look at what our future obligations are and our future ability to pay those obligations, that gap explodes from $20 trillion to over $200 trillion. Now, how is it that we're going to be able to close that gap? All right, now, the reason why it's okay to have me talk about these kind of issues after these two is because the reason how you close that gap is either, as Kotlikoff has pointed out, you're going to have to slash government programs by 40% across the board. That ain't going to happen. Or you're going to have to increase marginal tax rates by 60% at the same time that people don't respond rationally to the fact that their marginal tax rate has been increased 60%. That ain't going to happen. So what other kinds of things could actually get us out of this problem? One is trade expansions, tremendous economic growth due to expansion of trade. And the other one is technological innovation. So what drives those two things, right? One of them is immigration, right? The idea that you have a free flow of resources and of people, and you look at the ideas that individuals come from afar when they bring new ideas to a place, and what role immigrants play in an entrepreneurial culture is the way that we can maybe get out of that. But the reality is that existing politics of it, where the goal of politics is still to get elected, not to fall on a sword, right? So you're not going to run on, hey, vote for me, I'm going to raise your marginal tax rates by 60%. And so what you're going to do in politics is concentrate benefits and disperse your costs
which does nothing but, in fact, exacerbate the problem of the fiscal gap. This is it's an institutional problem that demands an institutional fix. And until we get our heads wrapped around that, we're going to continue to just doing business as normal. Well, here's the second problem. The Fed's balance sheet since the crisis. Whatever position you take on what's going on with the Fed, the reality is that we had QE1, QE2, QE whatever. We had Operation Twist, which devoted a ton of resources into that. And the money hasn't been coming out of the banks because, what, we've been paying interest on reserves. So what are we going to do? How are we going to get out of that situation? That's the key issue. Is there a possible soft landing to all of this? Keep in mind what Bernanke had in mind was the idea that he could flood the economy with liquidity, yet at the same time suck up the excess reserves. So the picture in your head should be, thing one or thing two. So from Dr. Seuss, so thing one, dumping cash into the economy, but then having a vacuum cleaner with his foot, sucking up the excess reserves. Now what happens if thing one doesn't get it right and causes a problem? Right? This is then the monetary expansion then connects with the fiscal irresponsibility, and then you get the system that we're currently always dancing on this edge of. And so we're going to have serious conversations about how to fix those institutions. Milton Friedman in Capitalism and Freedom, go and look at the chapter on money. He has a great line in there. He says, any institution where a sincere error by a few can threaten the entire system is not an institution that we can afford. It's time for us to start thinking about institutional fixes to our deviations from standard practice in monetary policy. Understand, nothing I've said, by the way, is all that radical at the moment. All I'm talking about is two things. One of them is the best practice in central banking, which is called Bagehot's rule. I might have problems with that, but that's the basic idea. And the other one is called optimal fiscal policy. So in Bagehot's rule, what you do is the central bank is the lender of last resorts, and what you do is you bail out only the solvent banks, not the insolvent banks. All right? And so you're going to design your monetary policy to serve in that rule. In optimal fiscal policy, you're going to run deficits during times of crisis, you're going to run surpluses during times of plenty, and over the life cycle of the business cycle, you're going to end up by having a balanced budget. All right? Now, apply basic economic incentives to those ideas, and then see whether our current institutions are able to even live up to those kind of standard best practices. That's going to be our real problem. So we got to deal with those issues, and that takes serious thinking of an institutional nature. Third thing is, and we do face this, and this fuels a lot of the populist rhetoric, is that there is a form of structural inequality that has emerged in the United States economy that's a consequence of the fact that we have gummed up our labor markets. So in all the studies of income mobility, so we still have income mobility across the quintiles, but it's not as fast as it once was. And there's reasons for that, which is that we have moved towards a situation where a lot of policies have made it less costly to not be employed and more costly to hire people. So simple standard economics, right? If you lower the cost of something, you'll get more of it. If you raise the cost of something, you'll get less of it. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure this out. And yet we somehow end up by gumming up our labor markets at all times. This includes some of the issues that Alex was just talking about with regard to immigrants integrating themselves into the U.S. economy and the difficulties associated with that. Imagine how difficult it will be if what you have is these kind of biometrics kind of things to get a job, let alone any other kind of things, and the increasing of the militarization of police and the checking of the box kind of idea that's associated with that. Just so that you sort of put your heads a little bit around this, in a study that was done in a journal called Juvenile Criminal Justice, okay, 54% of black males in America under the age of 25 have been arrested for non-traffic, non-violent related crimes. That's underage drinking or drug possession. Okay, now that's okay, but 49% of white males under that age as well. All right, that's because of the changes in the way in which we've reported getting the kids in the system that have been the output targets for our police across the country. So no longer do you grab the kid by the ear and bring him home and say, look, Chuckles is hanging out with the coconuts. Anyway, we face this problem of labor market rigidities. We've gummed up our labor markets in the United States. At the same time is that we've increased the returns to a rent-seeking society. And so we are moving away, in the classic terms, from a contract-based society to a connection-based society. 2 years ago, Thomas Piketty made, you know, everyone's, all us academics dream, because we would all love to write a book that everyone bought that no one read. It's a dream, right? You know, number one on Amazon and then no one read it, you know? So I would love to do this. But at the same time that he wrote that book, there's another book that was around by the economist Luigi Zingales called The People's Capitalism. And Zingales talks about the same problem. He explains how when he moved from Italy to come to the United States, his perception was that the United States was a strictly meritocracy. He was going to go to MIT, and then based on that, he'd be able to rise up. And he says, the problem today is when people perceive what's coming into the United States, it's a connection-based economy more than just pure merit. And that issue isn't just a perception issue. It's because we've unleashed rent-seeking. Think about the amount of money that Microsoft spends in Washington, D.C. today versus what they spent 25 years ago. All right? And that just gives you kind of an example of that. So we are in an overregulated, right, fiscally irresponsible, and we've deviated from sound money. And so we have a great distortion. And a great distortion, it needs a great recalculation, a great correction. The correction is, right, the recession is the correction on things. So we need to actually have a kind of correction to get the economy back on ground, and we need to have institutional fixes. Now, where is that going to come from? Well, we're overregulated. We've declined in economic freedom from number 2 to number 16 over the last decade. So those are kind of pessimistic ideas. But on the other hand, we are still an amazingly entrepreneurial economy. We still have tremendous innovations right around the corner from us. We still have possibilities of expanding trade opportunities. So if we can just make sure that trade and technology continue to push out our productivity, for example, Doug mentioned before how much to produce, how many man hours to produce a ton of steel, right? That's because of expansions in real productivity. Only way to increase real income is to increase real productivity. The only way to increase real productivity is to do what? Increase human capital, physical capital, and the rules which govern the way physical and human capital interact with one another. In countries that are suffering, what's the best way in which this technology gets transformed across borders is actually to have open immigration. Have firms come in and all that stuff like that. So we still have this possibility of trade and technology unleashing an entrepreneurial innovation which can overcome a lot of the silly policies that governments engage in. But they can't overcome a million impertinent obstructions. We still have to fight to make sure that we reduce the barriers to trade, we reduce the barriers to technological innovation. And that's the real sort of policy battle at the moment. We have to get back to that idea. And I think that the power of the ultimate resource, the human imagination, can overcome a tremendous amount of silly government activity. But we need to make sure that we create the conditions for economic freedom. Thank you.
All right, with that, we'll open it up for questions from everybody to all three panelists, and I'll ask you to, please, when you ask your question, to point out who you're directing it to.
How do you see the problem with immigrants, specifically in Europe, because most of what you're talking, it's in the United States, especially when it has to do with the different set of institutions that they bring with them. what some people say is that, well, the immigrants that came to the United States are Anglo-Saxon, or used to be Anglo-Saxon Protestants, but now we are talking about a different kind of immigrants that have a different set of institutions, and those institutions are not compatible with the current institutions in Europe or the United States that brought prosperity to those countries.
So, great question. First off, the religion that has dominated immigration in U.S. history from about 1835 until about 2012, every year, Catholics were the largest group. A majority of all immigrants in Asia were Catholics. And a lot of the criticism that you hear about Muslims and Islam today as immigrants are very similar to the criticisms of Catholics in the past, really up to the time that Kennedy was elected. You know, they're going to take cues from foreign leaders. The Pope is going to control U.S. elections and U.S. politicians. They're going to mobilize the vote and vote as a bloc and take over, as a lot of the fears in New York State in the 1840s and 50s, when there actually was a Catholic political party at that time. There was the idea that they all came from countries where there was either feudalism or autocracy. So they had zero traditions of liberty in the countries where they came from. So there was no way they would ever assimilate to a Republican form of government in the United States. And just so you know, that they came from illiterate societies like southern Italy or Ireland. And it just went down the list. And it took the Irish a little while to assimilate, mainly for other reasons. But Italians and all these other groups have done fine. So all these same things have been said before. But Europe does represent a little bit of a different case, but mainly for, well, mainly because the institutions in Europe are radically different than they are in the United States. And by two institutions, I mean a welfare state and labor market regulations, like what Pete was talking about. So two things. One, if you're an immigrant in almost any European country, you can immediately get the full battery of cradle to grave means tested welfare benefits immediately. And you are basically, it's impossible to work. If you're a refugee or asylum seeker, it is illegal in most European countries to work, actually, for the first period of time. So in Germany, I believe in the UK, you have to be there for about 9 months before you can work legally. In Germany, it's about a year. In Sweden, they make it very difficult. That's the opposite of how the US does these things. In the US, if you're a legal immigrant on a green card, you have no access to means-tested welfare benefits for the first 5 years, with the exception of emergency medical care. If you're on a guest worker visa program, you have zero access to means-tested welfare benefits, student visa, illegal immigrant, etc. That's very different in Europe. Also, labor market regulations. It's virtually because of the European rules make it so difficult to get a job. European employers favor the type of people they know, the type of people they can trust, because if you can hire somebody, you can never really fire them. You pay huge fines. So what they do is that they basically just hire other Europeans, people who they know and can trust. So they never take a chance on the immigrant from abroad who, you know, maybe doesn't speak French or German very well. So as a result, they never really get a chance in the labor market. And because they have welfare, they have no incentive to really try to work anyway. So labor force participation rates for immigrants in Europe and every country are far below that of natives. In the United States, labor force participation rates are far above those of natives. So much so that the illegal immigrant male labor force participation rate in the U.S. is over 90%, about 92%. For men immigrants, male natives in the United States in the same age range is about 62%. And a lot of that is because of that. So as a result of this also, because you can't get immigrant welfare in the United States when you come here, you have a self-selection mechanism. The people who want to work and work hard and don't want to be on benefits are the ones who come here. And in Europe, you have a situation where a lot of those who go there don't necessarily want to work. So you have a negative selection. And one of the ways that you can test this is by taking a look at Iranian immigrants who have gone to Sweden, Germany, the United Kingdom, Canada, and the United States. And that is the order in terms of the generosity of the welfare state and in terms of the amount of labor market regulations. And you can basically tell Iranians in the U.S. are far more skilled, making far, far higher incomes than native-born Americans, controlling for everything else. In Canada, they're about the same as other Canadians. They do about 20% worse in the U.K., about 40% worse in Germany, and in Sweden, they basically are as successful as Somalis, which means they're basically 80% worse than others, and that's controlling for everything else. So it really is the institutions of these countries that make the difference.
All right. Thank you. Other questions? John?
My question's for Doug, but this is a theme running through everybody. There's a lot of appeals to history, which is an important thing in your work, Doug, in the 30s. How important is theory about the importance of free trade and markets relative to, at least into convincing people about these benefits and costs compared to our lived experience, both the United States and other countries.
Actually, that's the theme of my talk later tonight to some extent. And I guess the quick answer will be that theory doesn't get you very far. So the famous incident in the 1930s was when the Congress passed the Sloan-Hawley tariff in 1930 and went to President Hoover's desk. Over 1,000 members of the American Economic Association signed a petition asking him to reject that petition, and it quickly went into the waste paper basket. It was just, well, he wasn't going to listen to the economists, what do they know? And it actually appears, people actually look back at that petition, it's actually very far-sighted and very well done in terms of predicting some of the economic consequences that actually did happen. So the advice of economists doesn't matter so much. I think what you put your finger on is lived experience is very important. Milton Friedman always says what convinces people is the lessons of experience. And I think one reason why I'm an optimist too about at least the spread of freer trade policies around the world is that those countries, and something I'll talk about a little bit more tonight as well, those countries that have embraced such policies have generally done very, very well. And so there you get sort of this dynamic of countries topping one another in terms of trying to emulate good policies. Just one quick example of that. You may know that, maybe you don't know, that Burma is recently going through this transition from a very repressive, harsh military dictatorship to trying to open up politically and economically. And there's a great article in the New Yorker magazine a couple years ago by a historian who was advising the generals about how you manage this. And what he said is, when you appeal to Western ideas about freedom and human rights as a way, reason to open up, they got nowhere with the generals. But when they said, you know, Burma's really falling behind in the world. And in fact, the per capita income of Burma has fallen behind Laos, a neighboring country which they usually look down upon. Now Laos is a richer country than we are because our economy is not doing well because we have all these repressive policies in place, including the political system. That's the article that could gain traction, that you say, look, we're not performing as well as our neighbor or our rival. We have to change our act and get in gear. And so I think that's sort of the lesson. There's only so much you can talk about theory and principles and ideas. It's sort of that actual practical experience that I think is very, very important.
Other questions?
This one's for Doug. So you mentioned this sort of issue of, you know, it's pretty standard stuff. So if other countries or America puts tariffs on our borders and other countries respond. So I think the response to that is, okay, well, what does America do then when other countries have tariffs on their borders? So what should America do in response to that?
Well, that's the whole point of trade negotiations. Try to get rid of those. And you know, I talked about the trade deficit issue. We actually have a trade surplus with the countries that we have free trade agreements with. So I think the big problem, we'll say, with China. We don't have a trade agreement with China, really, and they have very high tariffs and a lot of restrictive policies. I would think that we'd want to bring them into a TPP thing if they can commit to some of the disciplines that are in that agreement, which at this current stage they're not willing to do. So to the extent that we have willing partners that are willing to open up, and a lot of the other countries want to do it, not so much, it's partly to gain access to the U.S. market in terms of these trade agreements, but a lot of political leaders in other countries want to sort of tie their own hands in terms of their trade policy so that when their successors take over, they keep open markets. That's why they want a trade agreement. So to the extent that we can reach out to those partners, we should be doing so through negotiations. But once again, China and other countries that are much more mercantilist, there's no question about how exactly we address that, but we certainly don't have to give them the same treatment as we are willing, say, NAFTA partners or other countries that are willing to have a more level playing field. Let me just bring this back to Adam Smith. I'm wearing an Adam Smith tie. See if you have Adam Smith ties around here. Adam Smith said there's an exception for the case when a country has leverage with other countries in terms of trying to open up their market. So Africa is certainly open to trade bargaining and even to retaliatory tariffs, an effort to open up countries. So I think that gets into a political issue about how we should deal with China.
Pete, you know, of the two issues that you mentioned regarding the trade and technological innovation, I think really it comes down to technological innovation. I would say, you know, that's the basis, I think, that we could focus on. Now, when the fundamental issue that you brought up, that I think we need to seriously think about, is the fact that we have gone from an economy based on contracts and contractual kind of agreements, or the way of doing business, to a rent-seeking kind of economy. Now, given that it would be very hard to go back from how things work nowadays in the economy, and given that, you know, one of the big factors that helps technology move forward is investment. And given where we are today, 2017, we know that within the next 12 to 15 to 20 years, the greatest transfer of wealth ever seen in the history of the world will be taking place. In the US today, the silent generation and the baby boomers hold close to 2/3 of the wealth of the US. That amounts to about somewhere around $55 to $56 trillion. That wealth will be transferred within the next two decades. How do we communicate with those heirs that will obtain that wealth or will inherit that wealth to make the necessary investments to fuel up the technological progress? And then how do we go about making sure that, you know, once you go to rent seeking, of course, they will be seeking the fruits of that end up result, but how can we begin to address a sort of orderly kind of prioritization of those investments in the future? I think that that's the bottom.
It's a very big question. I think actually, you know, right on. My colleague at George Mason, Tyler Cowen, has kind of made a living on appearing to be a pessimist. So he wrote a book called The Great Stagnation. And then he wrote another book called Average is Over. And now he has a new book out right now called The Complacent Class. Basically, working backwards, in the complacent class, you know, we're too happy, fat, and stupid to be upset that things are getting bad for us. And so therefore, we don't take risks like we used to. And that's the complacent class. We got so wealthy that we became complacent. Now, why is it that, what's so wrong with being complacent? If incomes have grown so much, why the heck not? Like, you know, have another pina colada and ride a little bit more on the boat or whatever. Well, the reason is because in the Great Stagnation, the rate of technological innovation, Tyler hypothesized, it hasn't reversed, but it's slowed. And when the rate of technological innovation slows, then the government policies that are counterproductive pinch more. All right? So the way to think about it is that your total factor productivity curve has actually slowed, or like is not, it's not going like, so imagine you have it like this, and then, you know, you went like that, which is why you can now produce steel for so much less. Well, imagine if it was just this a little bit more. Right, and then those tariffs are going to pinch more, or those immigration restrictions are going to pinch more than what they previously did. All of us here understand that if you set a minimum wage at $15 an hour, but in your local community you pay teenagers $16 an hour to babysit, that the minimum wage wouldn't pinch much.
But if the minimum wage is $20 an hour and the kids can only make 16, now all of a sudden you're going to have disappointment effect. So these are the kind of things we have to look at on these technological, why are we slowing down? It's because of various different policies, and how are we going to reverse those? Now, what about the millennials? We usually complain about all of you, right? But if you go back and read, like, my grandparents, they thought my parents' generation sucked. Right, they were all like drugstore cowboys and everything like that. Until what? Until they went to fight Vietnam, fight World War II, and then they were like the greatest generation. Read about what people thought about kids in the 1930s before they fought the war. They were terrible. Right? Everyone hates teenagers. All right. Someday you will hate teenagers. All right. And when they're your kids and they're causing you to lose your hair. But what about the young kids, which is pretty cool? They actually have a kind of DIY culture. So this do-it-yourself culture. Now, sometimes it's terrible, right? I want to, fix my plumbing in my house, so I'll go watch a YouTube video, and then, like, I go, and then the water flies all over the house or something like that. So sometimes it's crazy, but that DIY culture actually can be tapped into that. I actually think this is the big missing thing. Now, this is not economics. This is now libertarianism or whatever. I actually think this is the biggest thing modern libertarians are missing, which is tapping into the youth and their DIY culture, which at its core is a libertarian position. Right, so rather than trying to teach them to, like, read Adam Smith or whatever, get them to, like, start their own businesses, sort of enter into markets. They all did it with their own records. They didn't go buy records anymore. They downloaded it. Right, so now, like, they should do that with everything. So everything should be Uberification. Right, think about Uber and then go across every single, like, commodity in the country, and then think about how could Uberification take place in that industry. How could these young people tap into this and, do that? And that's what I think would be a, the sort of answer to your question about how this bequest of this capital could be translated not into dead capital to allow them to, like, live fat, lazy, and stupid lives, but instead generate productivity that none of us could have ever imagined. That's what I think is the future. We're this far away from nanotechnology revolutions and all these things like that. My mom, by the way, God bless her, she's in the hospital right now. She went in the hospital. I've been checking, so I checked my phone. It's not because I'm checking scores. Anyway, it's but my mom is 91 years old, and she had a kidney stone, and they went in with this little, like, laser and blasted it up. It's amazing. 91 years old, just go in and be able to do that kind of stuff. Imagine the kind of, that's going to look like clunky technologies in the same way that we look back to surgeries in the 1960s in the year 2040, right? So maybe we'll swallow a little robot and the robot will go around and clean out all our arteries, and then we can, like, live terribly like I did because I believed in Julian Simon. And so therefore, he should invent a pill to make me weigh exactly what I weighed back in college again. That would be awesome. Right, and I'm going to take that pill, and I'm like, oh God, 50 years of crap, I paid it all off. But in reality, there are going to be these amazing innovations that are just around the corner, and those will translate those investments into something. But I can't tell you, that's more now science fiction than, like, science, but I think this DIY culture suggests something to us that we're not paying attention to, and we should be paying more attention to it. Is Cato paying attention to it? I am. Okay.
All right. Thank you. Probably one last question.
Thank you. It's a question for Pete. It seems to me that you are setting up what I would call the dynamic of freedom. Because you're saying open borders is good, trade is good, as long as we don't have these regulations for income mobility, such as minimum wage or things like that. So if we don't have those, then we cannot have open borders. Does it mean that if we don't have that freedom initially, we cannot have international trade? Is it that you're establishing that the first thing that we need to do is a more open market in the country, and we have to
get rid of all these regulations. And once we are able to do that, we can be confident that open borders and trade is going to work. Because otherwise, we're going to have some losers from immigration and from trade, and that's going to create populist governments like some governments here or in Europe.
Ben, I'll try to be quick. Look, I mean, the kind of thing that I'm trying to talk about in response to Eduardo is just going back to the idea of the non-scalar nature of increasing returns to innovations. All right, so you can't have, it's not like we're just going to have this smooth line. We have to experience this kind of burst of productivity. And where are we going to get that from? And that's going to come out of the accumulation of liberties, which unleash the entrepreneurial activity of individuals in that society. Now, I personally, if you go to like the pragmatics of what you raise, I would always side on the idea that we should continue to have, you know, freedom of opportunity and whatnot, or migrations or whatever, in whatever kind of system we have, because what you'll have is a self-selection mechanism, kind of what Alex was saying. Right now, Germany is suffering some problems, Sweden's suffering more because their policies have actually been counterproductive for their growth, but the United States is still having positive gains, not as great as we could have had, but still positive gains. And the reason is because it's like, you know, you and I running away from a bear. It doesn't matter which one of us is fast, it matters which one is relatively faster than the other. So right now the US economy is still relatively attractive. It's still in the mostly free economies of the world. It went from 2 to 16, but its actual numbers are from like an 8.6 to a 7.9 or something like that. So it's not like it's become like unfree. So it's still better to live in the United States than it would in the Congo. And so as a result, you're going to have better rates of return, you know, in that kind of broad brush idea. And so I would still argue that we should have free trade, even though it's not going to be as great as it would have been had we didn't have these kind of regulations to gum it up. And that are, and that's the way we have to go forward. Plus that, if you're in the right system, it can push in the right direction, because the pressure can push towards more freedom, not less freedom.
All right. Well, thank you all for participating in this. Thank you.